Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is Hany Ismail from Planning Engineer website. In this video, we are going to complete what we have created last one. I hope you managed to create your first project and you created WES. Now let's add some activities to our schedule. Before adding activities, let us see what are the activities types. There are six types of activities in Primavera P6. But I'm going to discuss only the most used activities. We have task dependent, start milestones, finish milestone. If you are wondering what milestones are, milestones have no duration, representing start or end of a certain event. I'll explain to you in detail. So the activity, the task dependent, it has duration, represents a task happening for a time. For example, masonry work in the first floor. So this is the normal task, the most used type of the activity type we are going to use in our time schedule. Start milestone. The start milestone does not have duration. It represents the beginning of an event. For example, phase A start milestone or project start date. You have some important dates, so you can represent these dates by using a start milestone. The finish milestone. Similar as the start milestone, does not have a duration, it represents the end of an event. For example, phase A finish milestone or project finish date. After we created the WBS, it is time to add activities. How we are going to add some activities? It is very simple. We just go here in the WBS, we would like to add activity. We will create add activity. This window will pop up. It will ask us what you would like to name your activity and what is the activity ID for it. I will pass it for now just to tell you this is how to add activity in Primavera from this add activity. Okay, if you notice that the activity also will be appearing in the Gantt chart area. So we have here the activities area and the Gantt chart area. Whenever we add activity here, we will find that we have activity here also. Same one. So our target is to create a small schedule for a project that consists of three buildings. So we have phase one. Under phase one, we will have building one and building two, as we can see here. And in phase two, we'll have building three and landscape works. How we can do this in Primavera? Simply, we will add activities here, building one, building two, and we'll add two activities in phase two, which is building three and landscape. Let's do it together. So here I have my first activity. I would like to rename it. So I'll click here and I'll call it building one. Okay. Then I will add a new activity. And in that case, I'm going to rename it from here directly building two, and I'll click finish. Now I'm going to copy these two activities. I'll click control and select all of them, right click, copy, and I'll come here in the phase two. I'll make right click and paste, and I'll click okay. Okay, now I have two more activities. I will change this one into building three, and I will change the name of this one into landscape works. You might be wondering, okay, why I cannot see the bar chart here? If you notice here that we are here in September 2024, but the time scale is in 2011. So click and drag, very simple, until we reach to 2024. Then you will find your activities. Here they are. Now they are looking very small. How we can enlarge them? If you come here, you will find this magnifier. Click and drag so you can make them looks bigger. Okay, if you notice that in my PDF or my presentation, let me minimize this one to show it to you. You will find the color here is red and blue, while I have different colors here. How we can change this one? This is very simple. Just go to here, group and sort, and you can change every WBS color. Click this one, make it red, click OK. Let's make this one blue. Click OK. OK. Apply. As you can see, dealing with Primavera P6 is very simple, nothing complicated at all. Now you will notice that the start and the same time, the next step is to do the relationships. But before doing the relationships on Primavera, I would like to explain to you the four different types of relationships. The relationship is the logical connection between activities in project schedule. These relationships define the sequence in which activity should be performed and help establishing dependencies among them. Okay, so we have finish to start. The finish of one activity determines the start of another. Start to start, one activity should start in order for the other activity to start. Finish to finish, one activity should finish in order for another activity to finish. And the last one activity should start in order for another activity to finish. Let us see the four relationships in more graphical way so we can understand. So the relationship between activity A and B is finish to start. This one should finish in order for this one to start. This is how it looks like in the relationship line, and you should be able to understand the relationship by looking at the arrow and from where it is going to where. This one is start to start. So this one, once it is started, activity B will be started. This relationship is finish to finish. This activity A should finish in order for activity B to be finished. And the last one, this activity should start in order for this activity to finish. It is simple. As you may dealing with the activities in your projects, you will find that you already understand this one in somehow. So now we are going to start with the relationship between building 1 and 2. Building 2 will start after building 1. That means building 2 is the successor of building 1. So in order to do the relationships, it is very simple in Primavera. From here, we should show the detailed window. And in the detailed window, we will find the predecessor or successor. I prefer to add one more tab by doing right click and clicking Customize Activity Details, and then you will find this one. And I need to have one tab called Relationships, and then I will remove the successor and predecessor, so I have both relationships in one tab. And click Apply. As you can see here, okay, I can see here the relationships. So going to building one, I will add a successor to building one. Successor means what? Successor means an activity will come after building one. I'm going to assign the relationship now by clicking assign, and I will select building two, make double click and close. As you can see here, nothing is changed, because whenever I do a relationship, I need to go to the schedule or F9 and click schedule in order to see the impact. So as we can see here that the building one now starting after building two. Can we do the same between building two and building three and building three and landscape work? We should have something very similar to what we have done. By we'll stand on building number two, then we'll assign the relationship, and we will use building three, double click, and then we'll stand on building three and assign the relationship to the landscape work. So simply, as we discussed, I'll stand here, assign, then I'll put building three. While I'm standing in building three, I'll put landscape work, and then I'll close and I will run my schedule. But if you remember, we need that landscape work to start at the same time of building three. So can we change the relationship type from finish to start? We can make it start to start. In that case, these two buildings are going to start, or these two activities are going to start at the same time. Whenever I do schedule, you can see them starting at the same time. Now we need to modify the duration in order to give every building some recent or some logical duration. But before doing this, let's us talk about duration estimation. We have several methods to estimate the duration according to the project management science. We'll start with the first one, the analog estimation. The analog estimation assesses the duration of cost of an activity or a project using historical data from similar activity or project. The old project historical data says that 100 meter cube of concrete for slabs took 3 days. Now in our new project, for every 100 meter cube of concrete, we'll put 3 days. So this is a very straightforward method of estimating duration. The other way is the parametric estimation. The parametric estimation uses the algorithm to calculate cost or duration based on historical data and project parameters. Same as the previous one, 100 meter cube concrete for slabs will take 3 days, but We have a special condition in this project that level of labor experience is less than before, and the weather is worse, so the duration estimation will be 6 days instead of 3 days. And the most famous one, actually the two of them are famous, 3-point estimate and bottom-up estimate. 3-point estimate, this will estimate the cost or duration by applying an average or a weighted average of optimistic, pessimistic, and most likely. Optimistic means the best case scenario. If I would like to do this task according to expert judgment, I need 2 days. This is in the best case scenario. However, in the worst case scenario or pessimistic, it will take 5 days. Most likely it will take 3 days. So there are formula to calculate the multi-point estimation. We have triangular distribution and beta distribution. Triangular distribution will simply take the optimistic plus pessimistic plus most likely, divide them by 3, then you have your duration. On the other hand, the beta distribution, which I prefer to use, optimistic plus pessimistic plus 4 times the most likely, will divide all of them by 6. In that case, it will give you more accurate data. So here, the triangular distribution will give us 12 hours in this case, because the pessimistic is 17, optimistic is 7, most likely is 10. However, the beta distribution, which is more accurate, will give us only 11 hours. The other way of estimating the duration is using bottom-up estimation. We are using it all of time, but you might not recognize the expression they are using in the project management. The bottom-up estimation, the most accurate technique, better used for complex activities that consist of more than one sub-activities. So we have here the activity is the reinforced concrete for 100 meter cube of slabs. So we will decompose the activity into smaller activities, like formwork will take 2 days, steel reinforcement will take 1.5 days, concrete boring 0.5 day, curing 4 days, so the total duration will equal to 8 days. Now let's change the duration of our project we have created into these values. Simply to change the duration, you need to show first the column here called duration. So I make right click, I will go to the columns. You might have this column, so if you have it, no need for doing this step. I'm going to duration, we call it here original duration, I'll make it double click. Now I need to have the duration after the activity names. I don't need this column, so I'm going to remove. Okay. Now I'm going to click apply. So I have here the duration. I will make this one 100. This one also I will make it 110. This I can change it to 80. And this one I will make it 90. Oh, but I noticed that now I cannot see the full bar chart. You remember the magnifier, this one you can click and drag like this. Then we need to do the schedule in order to see the schedule in the proper way. And here is our schedule. Now we would like to view the columns. Now let's change our project start date, show the dates columns, and schedule our projects. So in order to set a plan date for our schedule, we are going to go to project and choose our project, and then it change the planned start date. How we can do it? Very simple. Just go to enterprise, projects, we'll select our project from dates here. Let's click and drag this one like this so we can see it. We can put the project planned start. Let's make it 1st March 2024 or whatever date you want. Okay, as you can see here, this is the target start date of our project. Now we will show some columns as we did before in the duration section. We can do the same here in the columns. So let's show. Now we would like to go to again to our project. So we have one of two ways, either if right click and open project, or if we are here in the project and it is already open, you can go simply to the activities. Now we would like to show some dates like planned start, planned finish. Right click, go to the columns, you will see this window from dates. You can now choose planned start and planned finish to show here planned start and planned finish, and you can rearrange them like moving them up and down from these arrows. So here let's have activity name,
and the blend start, blend finish, duration, make it up. We don't need this one. You can click apply. Now you can see the blend start and blend finish for each activity. One last step we talked about it, that you need to schedule your activity according to the data date, which is 1st March. How to do this one? Very simple. Just go to here, schedule, and choose the date you would like to run your schedule here, and choose 1st March, and you can run your schedule. As we discussed before, that you might need to change the duration. You can always change the duration from the column here. Before closing this video, I would like to talk about important definition, which is float. If you are in a project team, you must have heard of the term float. You heard the project management guys always saying this activity has high float or don't work on it. Start with the activity that has less or zero float, which is critical. What is the float? Have you asked yourself what is the float? How do we calculate the float? What the differences between total float and free float? Why should I know and understand the term float? What are the critical activities and what is the relationship between criticality and the float? We have here a project starts. Then we have activity number one, activity number two, activity number three, and this is our project is going like this. Now, from this point to this point, this is called free float. Free float means the amount of time an activity can be delayed before affecting the next activity. So the activity 3 can delay all of this duration and will not affect the activity 5, because activity 5 is starting here anyway. So this is what we called free float. But total float is the amount of time an activity can be delayed without impacting the project finish date. So definitely this activity has zero total float, because once this activity finishes, the project is finished. However, this activity can be delayed a little bit until it reaches here before it impacts the project. So the total float is the amount of time an activity can be delayed without affecting the project. But the free float, the amount of time activity can be delayed without affecting the successor activity. If we said that activity 3 total float is 7 days, that means activity 3 can delay up to 7 days without delaying the project end date. What if an activity has zero total float? That means the activity, if the activity is delayed by 1 day, this will directly affect the project end date by 1 day. That's when we call the activity critical. Critical activity must be completed on time to avoid delaying the overall project. These activities are part of the critical path, which is a sequence of tasks determining the minimum project duration. Near critical activities are tasks that are very close to be critical, meaning they have a small amount of total float, let's say 1, 2, 3, something very small amount of total float. Near critical activity has small total float, often just a few days, while they aren't critical right now. A slight delay could make them critical. So critical activity, no float, directly affect project completion. Near critical activity, small float, at risk becoming critical with small delays. That's why we need to keep an eye on the floats. In P6, there are columns for floats where you can know the free and total float for each activity. Try to find them by yourself and adding to your schedule. We need to add total float. We need to add free float. Try by yourself. See you in the next lesson.